I want to show you a method to really accurately mark out anything where you have to complete your lines all the way around a square or rectangular piece. Now, if you had your, if these edges were sharp, you could just use your combination square. But you can see this just doesn't really want to behave because it's got these real radiused edges. So what do? You come over here, draw your line, and then try to tip your square, and it's a waste of time, and it also introduces error into your marking. So in this case, you would just use your dividing head. Now the real trick whenever you do any kind of marking, whether you're using a scribe like this, a silver streak marker, a big fat pencil, or a more refined pencil like a mechanical pencil, is you know that it's not going to be, you're not going to be able to make your line exactly against the edge of this perfectly straight thing. There's going to be some standoff, you know. So when you use a silver streak marker, you can see the distance in there, that standoff. Now what you want to be able to do is you want to be able to transfer this line that's your marking line all the way around. So now if you come down here and if you put your square exactly up against that line, you're going to be off, because you're going to then introduce that same standoff distance, and so you're going to be shifting it each time you rotate. So the key, and always the most fundamental thing is you always just put your tool right back on your line, your marking tool, and then bring your square up to it. So then when you mark, you're making the same relative standoff. So it's just a real kind of backwards way that you would think about doing it. So I'm going to find my exact center here with my scribing tool. I'm going to bring my square up to it. Make sure that looks good. Yeah, that looks good. Bring your tool up to it. Your marking device, marking square. Now here's the thing. So I've got it exactly bisected. Now what you do is you just put your, in this case it's going to be the scribe. If you were using a pencil or a silver streak marker, you'd put that in your line. But here I'm going to stick that right in my line. I'm going to bring my square up to this. I'm going to stick my scribe in my line. So this works whether you're using a big fat pencil where it's really going to stand away from your square, whatever. You just always put your, let's just do it here with this silver streak marker now. I think this will be really easy to see. So the first thing I'm going to do is So now I just put that exactly in my line, as close as I can get it. Bring my square up. Put the marker on the line. Bring the square up. So it's kind of backwards to what you would think. You'd bring your square up right to the line, but then you go, well, how close do I really get it? And then so here I've got that exactly on that, and so I mark it, and then you can see that it shifts the mark off again. This way you're always marking the exact same relative distance off of the square edge as you wrap or a square or a rectangular piece. So it just works real well. Let's just do it again. I think the silver streak really kind of shows what we're going for. So you can see the distance. Now I just put my square, my silver streak right back on my line again. Silver streak right on the line. So that always lets you get that same continuation of your line by making sure that the marking tool that you're using is standing off of your square by the same relative distance. And that's real important. So I do this all the time where I have to wrap a piece for marking out tenons or whatever. And if you do it this way, where you put your pencil on your line and then bring your square up to it to make your transfer, it'll be perfect every time if your stock is square. But this is so much better than bringing your ruler up to the line, marking it, and then, because you're not going to keep that same relative distance off of it. So you put your marking tool on your line and then bring your ruler up to it, versus the other way where you bring your ruler up to your line and then you put your marking tool. I remember when I marked this, I had this piece shimmed up with some of these old Japanese saw blades. And so I want to take into account here so that you can see that I've got my piece shimmed up with that. I mean, it's minor. You could probably do it, but I just don't like adding error into my pieces. I don't want my bolt in there a little bit cocked if it just takes a second to fix it. So now I've got both of them shimmed up on both sides, and I see I've got my relationship right. So I'm just gonna switch this on this side. Actually, I'll just flip this around so you can see me mark it. So now I'll just peen that and drill it out, and it'll make sure that bolt is going to go through there exactly right. But I know what you're saying. You know, this is this thickness here, you know, it's a half a millimeter is what it would do, but it just takes a second to do it right. All right, I've got all my steel pieces bolted together. I don't have them tightened down yet, but I just wanted to show you why it's so important to do the little bounding jig that I made to mark all your pieces so then you can drill accurately. And I'm going to do this in one shot so you know that I'm not joshing you here. And I apologize for talking with something in my mouth, but I have a sore throat because I'm still sick. So I have a lozenge in my throat to help me talk. I apologize. I know that's pretty rude. But, so yeah, this all came together real nice. I got all my holes drilled, but I just wanted to, so I'm not going to stop the camera here. I just want to show you these marks or these measurements. So here's one end just kind of aligned. I mean, maybe there's, 32nd of an inch in here. That may just be because this also isn't, I haven't set this square yet, so it probably could pull and straighten out a little bit. But anyway, that's pretty close. That's close enough to, to press onto wood. Now let me just walk to the other side without turning the camera off. So, it's close enough, but if I would have just started marking and trying to free form it with a tape measure and stuff, I can be sure that it wouldn't be this close. But it helps to make a jig. And then also, see, now I'm not going to have my ends interfering, so all these ends fit inside. Remember the way I made it a standoff with the ruler, so none of those ends are going to interfere with my press as I bolt this all up to the wood. And that also, doing that bound also took away any variation in the length that I cut these, because I just freehanded them with the porta band and then just touched the ends with the grinder, so they weren't exactly all cut to the exact same length. So if you started pulling measurements off of them, if you started pulling measurements off of them,
I don't know how my iPod started there.
You could introduce error because of the dissimilar lengths. Okay, I'm gonna keep moving. Poppy, are you in trouble? You're not in trouble. You always look like you're in trouble, though.